You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension of not only a film and sound, but mind. A journey into an auditory movie review adventure that must be experienced to be believed. There's a signpost up ahead. Your next stop,
the Doomsday Clock.
Wych versus the Doomsday Clock.
Week 93, 1 hour 0 minutes to Doomsday.
We are now going to join this show already in progress.
Yeah, and I went, yeah, okay. And he just said, if I ever leave, don't drink the coffee ever again. And I went, good to know. And because we've been talking crap, and as I mentioned, it's all over and time is coming to an end. The voice you've just heard, ladies and gentlemen, is the fantastic Duncan McLeish. And we're going to be watching Mega Time Squad.
Oh, how are you?
Serious talk. They want to start using wild leads as a spot for gambling drops.
So what's the story?
You're going to flog the thing.
Me?
You can take your girlfriend as well.
Where is it?
It's down there. I never thought anybody would be stupid enough to steal from Triads.
Oh, yeah? Well, you never met us then, did you?
What's this?
Not for sale.
Oh, multiple tangos, plan B.
Very dangerous. Demon will consume you.
Can I bring it back, like, exchange it?
You will bring it back.
Yeah, because it's made in China, eh?
He's nicked the Chinese money.
That's the Wally bracelet. Wally thought this bracelet was wicked, but there was a catch. If you meet your other self while time traveling, that's when the demon comes. Be careful with that thing.
So what do we do?
Everyone be calm and everything will be sweet.
Well, you don't reckon we need a plan?
No, just trial and error.
Be cool and everything will be sweet.
I let other me go.
Do you see that? What are these clowns doing?
We like our own game. Now the John Squad. The Time Squad.
Mega Time Squad.
Mean.
Where did you bloody come from?
Oh my god!
Wait till I tell my mum about this.
Because it is choice, bro. And I work with a lot of Kiwis, and it's just fucking. It takes physical effort to not call everyone bro and say choice.
So that's a thing, right? Oh, right. I just thought they overplayed it in here, so that is an actual thing.
Fuck no. No. That is a real thing, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But right now, as I mentioned, this is 2018's Mega Time Squad with a runtime of 1 hour and 26 minutes. IMDb reckons that John steals money and a bracelet, or a temporal time dislocator, from a Chinese antique shop. Fleeing, he triggers the device and goes minutes back in time. The time travel results in new Johns, and they form the Mega Time Squad. That's not really what happens, but still nonetheless. there's a lot of dickery in this movie. No two ways about it. There's a lot of fucking dickery. It's directed by Tim Van Dammen, best known for producing, writing, and directing this movie. Directing, he was fully committed. This bloke was full. He was all in. He's just gone, fuck it, I'm in. He directed a couple of episodes of Wellington Paranormal, which is pretty cool if you've not seen it.
I have indeed. It's good.
It is good. And he had a role as a street demon in 2015's Deathgasm.
It's all kind of full circle.
All ties in together. This stars Anton Tennet as Jonny or John Brugh. best known for this and some New Zealand TV. And he also did an episode of the Power Rangers Dino Thunder.
I didn't even know that was a thing.
But they're all made in New Zealand, so fucking, I'm pretty sure everyone's been on that. And there's another show I'll mention later that everyone else has also been on in New Zealand. And you'll go, oh, yeah. This also has Jonny Brugh as Shelton, best known for this movie, and personally as Deacon in the What Do We Do in the Shadows? No. Is it What Do We Do in the Shadows? What We Do in the Shadows.
What We Do what in the Shadows.
What we words are hard. What We Do in the Shadows movie and TV series, which I've just found out apparently has just got a third season.
Yep, season three. I've still to pull the trigger on season one. I'll get there eventually.
You've got to get on board. You have got to get on board with it. It's fucking the most recent episodes have had Mark Hamill in them as a vampire, and it's fucking hilarious.
I've heard this. Time, however, is a flat circle, which means that eventually I will get around to it, but. I don't know if you know this, but summer's about to kick off, and that means I've got a lot of movie watches. So
yeah, I'm vaguely aware that there is a lot of a lot of movies to watch during summer and to report on. And really, you've got the task of it's beyond wrangling cats. It's like wrangling cats on Ritalin.
Yes, I wish I had a mega time squad. You know what I mean?
That's what it is. It's all just a massive group of Duncans organising. We now know how he does it, ladies and gentlemen.
The motherfuckers are on to me. Out of the
we're on to much like Hetty Gaskell-Hahn, who plays Kelly, best known for this movie and the New Zealand equivalent of Coronation Street, which is Shortland Street. Trust me, Shortland Street has been running for like 300 years, right? Dear. Everyone that's ever worked in fucking New Zealand television has worked on Shortland. It's like Neighbours, but like in, I think it's centered around a hospital from vague memory, but it's been going for fucking ever. Everyone has been on Shortland Street. It's
dear
choice.
God. It's choice.
Choice. And of course, I'd be remiss without mentioning the small role for Milo Cawthorne as Damage, best known for Deathgasm, Bloodpunch, which is one of my favourite time travel movies, and most recently in Guns Akimbo, which is a fantastic movie if you've not seen it.
It's not, my understanding is it's still not available properly in the UK, but once it is, I'll be on it.
I got to see an advanced screening before everything went to shit. where the whole world fucking ended and we all got trapped at home. And it's fantastic. It is a fucking top.
You could not have timed the end of your show any better, by the way. Like, you'd be sort of run right up from the good times right into a pandemic.
Yeah, it's fantastic. It's just like it was made for it. You know, anyone would have thought that somehow I went back in time and went in 3 years... bad shit's got to fucking happen, and just retroactively, that would suggest that I actually like plan stuff, and that doesn't happen. So fuck it. Now, you know what? Let's just go into our first impressions of this movie, and I'm gonna say it: this is the most Kiwi-ass fucking movie that I have watched in a long time. There were even points where I had to go, hang on a minute, even I have to translate that in my head. And I, like they call everybody bro. Hey, bro. Hey, good bro. Kia ora, bro. Which is hello in Maori. It's kia ora. And it goes, kia ora, bro. And it's great. But oh my
kia ora is a kind of a gesture.
They make cordial.
Yeah. That's fucking nuts.
Yeah, I know. It's fucking, for the rest of the world, they're going, why are they saying cordial? That's dumb. Yeah. But for, yes, for our Maori brothers and sisters, yeah, that's Maori for hello. And I've worked with a guy who greets me every day with, kia ora, bro! And it's like, yeah, kia ora, guys. It's fucking great. Kiwis are like more relaxed than Aussies. If that was like, Aussies are pretty fucking chill. Like, but you know, we can step it up into like fucking mental really quickly. Mm-hmm. Kiwis just stay like pretty chill unless you fuck them off, and then all of a sudden they become huge monsters and will like crush your head.
This is the Scottishness in them. Lots of Scots relocated to New Zealand. Lots and lots, yes, and lots of them. So yeah, that unfortunately they went across to a warmer climate and embraced that relaxed, fit attitude. However, they did not manage to purge from their genes the Scottish rage. Sorry, I apologise. That takes many, 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 many generations of outbreeding, not inbreeding, to get rid of. So just be warned.
Yes. And on the plus side for the rest of us, they were faced with Maoris and Islanders who went, what's that little white man? just sort of balanced out really well. Like I said, there's even like the very first bit when Johnny's talking to Shelton. How are you, Shelton? Box of birds, Jonny. And I've gone, what? Not even I know what fucking box of birds means.
Google, please translate.
I actually like sent a text to one of my mates going, what's fucking box of birds, bro? And he went, I fucking know. He goes, who said it? And I said, I was like in this movie. And he goes, where is it from? And I told him, and he goes, must be like a northern thing, mate. And I went, yeah, okay. Yeah, thanks. That's a massive fucking help.
the thing about Mega Time Squad, I think you can, like, in a lot of respects, I really like that idea of them just going full in with the, this is, you know, this is the lingo, this is how people talk and all the rest. Because, like, there's a weird bubble that's come up round New Zealand kind of horror cinema, genre cinema and comedy cinema specifically. In the space of about 5 years, it's mushroom climbed. Like, all the way out from what we do in the shadows, but I'm thinking about things like Housebound, you know, Mega Time Squad, Deathgasm, you know, all these movies are coming out, like, in relatively close proximity to each other. And what I love about it is the indier end of that, which is specifically Mega Time Squad, because it ain't a lot. Yeah. It's not got a lot of money, but that's fine, because they use it right. But when you look at that side, they really are just, this to me is a movie that's made for New Zealanders by New Zealanders. And if the outside market gets on board with it, that's kind of great. But if they don't, you know what? That's fine. Yeah. And I'm glad that you've explained the bro thing to me, because I just assumed it was like an in joke in here, but I understand.
No, to a man, bro is just every day. Yo, bro, kia, bro. Cuz and cuz. Sure, cuz. It's just, look, as I said, I work in an industry that is, there's a lot of Kiwis in it, because they start in New Zealand and then come over here to get real jobs.
You're a bad man.
No, yeah, I'm a bad man, but you know what, it goes both ways. They say
it does go both ways. I work, and like my immediate boss is from New Zealand, so... She's got a PhD though, so she isn't referring to people as bro or anything like that. But yeah, like if you mistakenly mention something as being from New Zealand that's from Australia, you get hell.
She will stomp all over you. And it doesn't take long for the veneer to just fucking crack and go, you fucking what? Fucking, it'd be like, it's like Crowded House are from New Zealand. The Finn brothers are fucking New Zealanders. Yeah, cunts.
She's like that. You know what? You should drink the coffee.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, no, I know it's a bit sludgy. No, fucking drink up. Drink up, champ.
See, in the case of this movie, like, before you even like talk about specific scenes or anything like that, There's two things this movie has that I think make it work, even though at times it's a bit I'll use a Scottish term here, shugly, not safe on its feet. You know what I mean? There's a couple of, because why not? If we're flinging regional dialect and lingo in here, let's go all about it. But the two things that sell the movie is that the movie has surprisingly competent special effects, like CGI special effects. They look okay. They're kind of almost computerized, like kind of computer game-ish. And that's okay.
Yeah,
that works.
Very similar.
Yeah. And then the second thing is the soundtrack. The soundtrack is 100% synthwavy bliss, and it fits the movie 100%. You can hide a lot with a good soundtrack. You know what I mean?
Like, yes.
Yeah. Not a lot of the greatest action sequences can be happening on the screen, but if that's got a pounding synthwave beat in the background, that's the best thing you've ever seen. So, so like those two things. Like, above all else, I think what drags this movie from being a super obscure kind of, all right, I see what you tried to do there, movie into something which I think maybe does translate a bit better, even if the dialect doesn't.
Yes, would fully agree. And it's all, like you said, it's all in. Mm-hmm. Right? There's no fucking pretense. There's no pretend accents. There's no bullshit about going, you know, we need to internationalise any of this. Nah, fuck that shit. It's just flat out. This is, well, locally it'd be the western suburbs of any fucking, like, pissy city in Australia. But it's New Zealand. And it's just like, yep, straight away, I'm there, I'm having it. Yeah, and look, you know, they even went as far as to throw in L&P. And I went, fuck me, that is like the, right next to like Kiwis, L&P is like the most fucking New Zealand thing ever. Like, it's their national soft drink. Like, fuck it, you, like, Kiwis here will go, oh, I've got to go to the shop, bro, to get some L&P. And it's just like, fuck, what? Oh, yeah, because they won't drink local soft drink. No, fuck that, bro, I want L&P, man. And it's just like, so, you know, that, like, no one else, like, outside of New Zealand gives a fuck about L&P. But they went and went, you know what, we're going to go to Paoa just to fucking put in L&P. And it's just like, all right, fucking sell that shit. Sell that fucking shit. Oh, my God. I love it. I fucking... that's why, you know what, fuck the format. Fuck everything about this, about what I'm doing. Regardless of the fact that, like, Bo broke the format two shows ago because, well, Piranha 3DD and he went, fuck that shit.
Bo breaks all formats on. That's the problem.
He is the format breaker. not the thirst breaker or anything else, the fast breaker. He's the format breaker. He's Bo Ransom, fuck it. But this movie is just like fucking all in. So, the short version, now that we've just sort of talked around it, Jonny, I like how he goes from, you know what, we got to do a job for Shelton to, like, hold up an old guy and steal money to just fucking escalating to straight escalation. You know, right down to, you know, the duck mask.
Oh, God.
The fucking... They're holding up the old Asian guy who doesn't give a shit.
He's been here before. Fucking, he knows what's happening. They don't know, but they're going to know.
Yeah, they're going to know. He's going, you know what, if you're dumb enough to steal from the fucking triads, yeah, you get what you take. And if you want to steal this, yeah, the magic fucking thing, I can warn you once, and then it's all on you. And
it's gremlins, yeah, isn't it? It's 100% gremlins.
Never steal stuff from old Asian men or boys.
You don't want that. You can't handle this. Like, I'm telling you that because I'm an old Asian man and I have been here longer than you will be, white man. Listen to me. And you never listen. You never heed their warning. And there's a reason that the Chinese civilization has been around for a lot longer than anyone else. It's because they know when not to steal cursed artifacts that play with time.
Yeah, that's right. Someone says it's cursed, you go, well, okay, fucking leave it. But no, apparently not. No, you just steal it and go, oh, thanks, bro. But I like the bit with, can I return this if she doesn't like it? And I'm going, this is like, oh my God, you are such a dick. Such a dick. And they're just like, yep, you know, they steal from the old man. Go and have a beer at the bowling club. Because that's like the only place you can get a beer. Because apparently there's no pub in town, but they're drinking long necks at lunchtime, and I'm there going, that is awesome.
Long necks, translate.
You won't see that. All right, so short bottles, like 350 mils.
Oh, right, right, I've got stubbies. Got you. Yeah, got you.
Right, so short bottles, stubbies, big bottles, so Is it a liter? No, I think it might be. Yeah, I think it's a liter. Like a full liter bottle. That's a long. Like here, when I was a lad, you would buy. You'd buy half a dozen VB long necks, with VB being like local fucking brand cheap beer. And and you would, like, if you drank fucking long necks, you're as hard as, mate. There was a guarantee if you were drinking long necks, you had a packet of Winnie Blues folded up in the sleeve of your black t-shirt.
I'm fucking an education here. This is better than Rosetta Stone. I'll tell you that Rosetta Stone could go fuck itself. Which does Australia?
So they're drinking fucking long necks at lunchtime. So they've literally gone to the bar and said, "Just give me a couple of full size bottles, like liter bottles." And they're just they're going, "That's awesome. That just says, just fucking Westie, don't give a fuck." Just if they'd had a packet of Winnie Blues, that would have pushed it. I would have been doing laps in my house going, "Yeah, it's everywhere." It's so bizarre. It is so bizarre that, it's from there from, well, you know what? If we stole from the old man, we can steal from Shelton. And it's just like, are we doing it? Are we doing it? Are we going to do it? Ah, fuck it. We're going to do it. And are we talking about it? No, we're going to do it. No, we do it. And then all of a sudden, Jonny apparently needs to grow some nuts. There's a lot of talk about Jonny's nuts in this movie. A lot of talk about Jonny's nuts.
Poor Jonny's nuts. Sheldon is a character, right? Or Jonny Brugh, playing him. Jonny Brugh. You wouldn't instantly associate, Hardman, you know what I mean, with him as an actor. And even then, I don't think he necessarily... There are a couple of scenes where I'm like that. Yeah, I could imagine you heading a gang, but, there's something about he's a total sleazeball, and I love that about... That's what this movie needs. You need, a sleazy kind of... A guy who has all this muscle around him. You're like, this... You know, if at any point this muscle decides that they don't want to listen to Sheldon anymore, he's gone. You know,
he's fucked. He's fucked. But none of them are that bright. Like, they're not bright enough to go, hang on a bit.
Yeah, he's purposely, surrounded himself with a lot of kind of thick muscle. I say thick as in not intelligent. And, I love that, kind of aspect as well. Can I ask, because I know we're working through it, but, I love time travel movies. I've always loved time travel movies. It's a kind of geeky little passion of mine. And I don't always get as hung up as some people do when it comes to, post-viewing a movie, did it make sense? And I know some people really get on with that, Looper couldn't have happened because, it's just a movie.
Just fucking have fun with it.
This one is of all the times to get, annoyed at egregious mistakes and things like that, this movie did not at the beginning say based on a true story, so fuck off, right? Didn't say that, right? So, don't direct that to any other movie that says based on a true story and throw your shit at that. But, there's a small group of them where I actually think, surprisingly, there's a bit more attention paid to the story than you would expect. Mega Time Squad is one of them. Not that I'm going to say. I don't want to upset any of your kind of quantum mechanic physicist friends and listeners.
I have a great number of quantum mechanic physicist friends that regularly contact me and go, "You know, reality." So anyway, people stand in.
In terms of the loops and how characters interact and the way it's built up, specifically with aspects in the movie which don't make sense the first time you watch them, but when they loop through, they do. This has, once again, considering its low budget, kind of haphazard nature and very rural kind of dialect, it's surprisingly well written in that aspect. It reminds me a lot, and it's because we've been chatting backwards and forwards a while ago about kind of doing a triple bill between this Bloodpunch, which you mentioned, which is also a great example of small indie movie, but actually does quite a bit clever work with the kind of time travel aspect and Time Crimes as well, which is another movie which is shot for fucking peanuts. You know, not an expensive movie at all. Very small budget, very small cast, but the premise of the time travel is surprisingly well thought out. And
oddly enough, the last episode, you weren't aware of this, but I actually recorded a whole episode on Time Crimes with Boz just last night.
Well, he loves him some Time Crimes. He's a big friend of Nacho Vigalondo.
Nacho Vigalondo.
Yeah, so
Nacho Vigalondo.
But that's like, to me, that's where it all works. And a good fact, like, you don't have to be Back to the Future. You don't have to have the sprawling 3-decade. You don't have to go down that road. If you're going to do something, why not, especially with time travel, like, make it, like, a couple of hours, or make it, like, you know, like, 10 minutes or something in terms of a loop, because when you start doing that, like, the amount of fuckery you can get up to in storytelling is brilliant, especially when it comes to, well, just don't make that mistake again, right, jump back 5 minutes before so you don't make that mistake, or I made that decision, I really wish I hadn't. It's not like I have to go back and throw Hitler's baby off a wall, you know, or... You know what I mean? I don't have to do that. I can just do the jump just before the thing that went wrong for me and try it again. And you know what? If that doesn't work, I'll jump back again and try it again. And I'll jump back again. And I'll just keep doing it. And that's why, like, when the Mega Time Squad kind of assemble at the end, I mean, there's a whole lot of... This movie does kind of, like, wander off into the sunset in a way which you're kind of like, no. It kind of feels a bit reckless, but... I don't give a fuck, because this movie doesn't give a fuck. And that's what kind of makes it, like, super entertaining, is when it finishes, you're like, yeah! Then, like, maybe later on, you're like, huh? But you're still like, yeah! And then synthwave them, hit them with a synthwave.
Synthwave it into, that's right, off into the sunset, and they live happily ever after. And then you go, ah, fuck it, don't worry about it, not going to worry about it. Now, there's a point that you've just raised about going back 5 minutes and fixing that thing. Mm-hmm. And that brings me to one of the things that, I'm going to, look, New Zealand, much like Australia and Scotland, not a country with a lot of guns.
No, we have. Well, I'm sure there's someone somewhere that has a lot of them. I just don't see them.
On a general basis, though, you don't see them. You know, there's not license to carry laws and all that sort of stuff like our US friends have.
Yeah, I think if you
bear arms or arm bears.
Yeah, if you I think if you. Rambo bear for the win. I think if you look at those three countries, if you actually analyse the death data or the murder data, you will find that I think gun crime is like less than 1% of murder deaths in Scotland. So that says a lot. I think in America it's all the death, including natural.
He had a gun, he looked at a gun, and then he fucking died.
He died calmly, surrounded by his family, in his bed with an AK-47.
That's right, for home security. So getting back to the point, Grandma is in the bank with a fucking shotty.
Yes, that's how she rolls.
In a $2 carry bag, and I'm going, fuck yeah. no one fucking batted an eye that Granny had a fucking shoddy in the bank. And I'm going,
yep.
I mean, admittedly, it's a pretty shit bank, really. Because apparently it's a bank, they don't have any money. This is a bank, we don't have any money. He's a die pack in a fucking metal tin that has $38 and some checks in it.
It's funny because she rolls in with, you know, she comes in with she's there with a shotgun. And according to Bowling for Columbine, when you go to set up a bank account in America, they give you one. Here's a gun.
The guy, he's a checkbook with poodles on it and a gun. There you go. Thanks for being a one-meanth customer. it's just fuck. But Jonny goes back, you know, 5 minutes and saves himself, which I thought was pretty smart. That was good work, Jonny.
Mm-hmm.
It was good work. Now, I don't know, there was a brief point where I actually stopped the movie and rolled it back before he goes to rob the bank.
Yes.
Even before he actually goes to rob the old man. And it's the sequence where he's like getting himself ready to do the initial crime, and he cooks a sausage with a lighter.
Yes, yes. E. coli is running rampant.
Yeah, I just like look. I've lived as a student, you know, off ramen and various other things, and you know.
Lighter cooked sausage by any chance? Question mark.
Not quite lighter cooked sausage. I have cooked a lamb chop by holding the bone over a flame. Not gonna lie, that not my proudest moment, but yeah, I did do that. I did just hold it there by the bone, just twisting them.
Were you out camping?
No, it was in the kitchen.
Right, yeah.
There were no clean pots.
The romantic mystique of that image in my brain has just been shattered.
No, just in front of the cooker, man. That's right. It's just for memory. I'm pretty sure I was wearing pants, which is good. But yeah, no, it was just fucking.
Yeah, you've got to wear pants just in case you get some of that rendered fat splatter. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's hard to explain away. but you know. Fun if you can get someone to kiss it better.
yeah, this could be my favourite review of anything ever, by the way.
It's just... But this movie, like, brings it to you. It doesn't take itself too seriously, and it's just like, you know what?
It doesn't at all. That's why, like, when Arrow Video announced that they were putting out... I think it played at London Fright Fest, and they acquired it just after that. And they're like, yeah, we're putting out the Mega Time Squad. And I remember seeing that the poster is... I think maybe the design set in the UK designed the poster artwork. I might be wrong about that. Don't shout at me, listeners, if I am. And I follow his stuff. I've interviewed him before. A great guy. I own his book. He's a fucking super nice guy. And that will usually, in a lot of respects, you know, I will throw a couple of shekels even at a release that I don't think I want if the artwork's been designed by someone that I like or someone, you know, involved with the project to someone that I've interviewed or whatnot. I like to do that. And like, I remember seeing the Arrow did, like, the produced trailer for it. And I saw it and I was like, this looks... fucking bonkers, like absolutely mental. I need to see this movie. And that was the big thing. Like, I've seen it three times now. I watched it last night on the run for this. And I will say that even on the third time watching this movie, it's as much fun, if not more fun, than that first time I watched it. And I don't think, like, especially with time travel movies, which we're talking about before, there is an idea of diminishing returns with them. Because once you know the secret, once you know how the sausage is made, so to speak, those movies start to lose their charm. And that's true, some in that genre do, but the fact that this movie, like I said before, it weirdly does fit and match up surprisingly well, but it at no point puts itself forward as a serious movie. It's not like Time Cop or anything like that, which is a totally serious movie. You know what I'm saying? It's not like that. It's having fun with it. You've got really well-written, really fast-paced, witty dialogue. Like, scenes where you're like that, yeah. Like, because that's the thing as well. Like, see, when people acquire time power, the power over time, like, it's you would fuck with it, surely.
God, yes!
You know what I mean? And I don't think enough movies do that. I think, like, oh, heavy is this burden that I have acquired to control the powers of time that I must be, you know, fuck off. You know what I mean? You'd fuck with it. For the first couple anyway, until you realise the gravity of your situation. But you would fuck with it, and Mega Time Squad 100% understands that you're gonna fuck with it a little bit, and it does it really, really well, and that's the fun aspect of it, is in a lot of ways is relatable whilst being completely unbelievable. And I think that is a fine line to toe in this movie, does it? And when it starts to lose that, synthwave. Unless you bring them back. Bring them back with synthwave.
Hammer into the synthwave. Yeah, and or, you know what, just throw in a completely Scooby-Doo scene.
Of course!
When all the Johnnies are moving, like, through fucking Shelton's house.
Yeah.
Totally fucking Scooby-Doo. Incredibly ridiculous.
Hard not to smile, when you're seeing it, though.
Yes. Because you just laugh. And then, you know what? If you're still not on board, let's show a picture of a water pistol that looks like a dick.
Yeah.
you know, that just fucking, that cuts through everything. Just the fucking... I was trying to work out, like, what Shelton was, you know, was he, like, fucking, you know, the shallow end of the organised crime pool? And then I went, no, he's like,
mm-hmm.
like... He's like the dudes from Only Fools and Horses mixed with, like, just a dead shit fucking dope dealer. You know, like,
yeah.
Just, you know, just not really fucking hardcore, not all that smart, but he's got his hands on all sorts of just random shit.
Yeah.
And somehow makes money out of it.
Because he's in the dead part of the town, like you were saying before. He's in that bit where, like, organised crime is going to have no fucking interest in. So he's, like, he is scrimping and saving and wheeling and dealing constantly to make himself a player. He is, weirdly in this one, he is the analogy of, you know, in the land of the blind, the man with one eye is king. Yeah, so, like, he is that, but it's, like, in the land of no money and no prospects, the man with muscle is king. That's literally it. But, like, muscle with no intelligence at all that he can manipulate. And as a result, has everyone doing everything for him all the way through this movie. He takes really no risk until the end, where he kind of has to fight for survival, so to speak. And even then, it's not really a fight, so to speak. And, you know what I mean? But that's kind of what I love about him, is that I think we don't see enough of that on screen either, as the small-time player, the person that is a complete... Like, and if this was an American movie, right, this would be, even if it wasn't a rundown part of a neighbourhood somewhere, or even if it was a British movie, it would be set in some rundown part of London. But the guy that would be in charge would be some, like, heavy, is some description. And, you know, he would have his finger and something, and he'd be making a play for the big time. And he'd basically be a character from a Guy Ritchie movie. And
not that there's anything wrong with that, by the way.
No, not at all. But that's what I'm saying. There would be some deal to make him a big player and all that. And I love the fact that this movie just doesn't deal with that at all, because it doesn't have to deal with that. This guy is a fucking total sleazeball, user, waste of space, who is perfectly played. I mean, one of my favourite roles in the movie is Shelton, because he really is, one, he's a great actor, he's got great comedic timing, but two, he plays it perfectly. And when you bring that element in there, sometimes it doesn't have to be about a $16 million cocaine deal that goes wrong. You know, sometimes it can be simply rob a bank.
Yes.
And those are the best.
A handbag full of Chinese money.
Yeah.
I didn't really find out how much it is. It's just a handbag.
We don't need to know how much it is. And that, once again, I love those aspects. Like, sometimes a story told on a macro level can have the same impact as one on a mass level. And that's the fun. That's the fun of Mega Time Squad. It's really actually, in the grand scheme of things, with the time travel, which could fuck the universe, the stakes are not super high. And they don't need to be, but that doesn't mean that you're not invested in everything that happens on the screen. And I think sometimes that's where good stories can be told, is when you just do it on a smaller level. It's like when you watch Deathgasm. I mean, Deathgasm, the ramifications are the end of the world, but it's handled through, you know, a small town black metal band. You know what I mean? And, like, sometimes you don't have to do the kind of larger, like, world view of how things will get fucked. Sometimes it's great to say, well, you know, if you, as the first line, it's Buffy the Vampire Slayer, my brain has connected all the dots, you're like, this is the Hellmouth, and if I don't control this Hellmouth in Sunnydale, then the world is over. But it's still in Sunnydale, and it's still five people fighting vampires. And you can do it on that level. I saw this is where I upset you, I'm sure it's an Australian movie, and is it Necronic?
it's Necrotronic or something.
Yeah, and that's an Australian movie, isn't it? Please tell me it's an Australian.
It is. Yeah. It's not a good one.
I'd like CGI'd within an inch of its life, very Power Rangers-esque in parts. And once again, full of that, like, that dialect that people refer to each other in ways that I don't understand. And that movie, it's the same idea, it's like a world view of how fucked things can be, but it's done on a small level because budget. budget and green screens.
Because budget.
And I'm fine with that. Mega Time Squad is small, insular story, huge ramifications, but his budget, and you know, like, and does at any point does Jonny Boy understand that if what he has falls into the wrong hands, everything is over? No. Does he care? No.
Doesn't give a fuck.
And I love that.
It's all about what Jonny can do for Jonny.
Yeah, he is our hero. He is the hero.
He's a hero who really, he just wants to get on with his new girlfriend, mm-hmm. drink a long neck, have a pie, mm-hmm. and I love the fact that when they end up in the fucking, in the honeymoon suite, and they have pies.
Yes.
It's just a choice! Oh, yeah, fucking choice, bro. This is classy Aspen.
It's so good.
You know, it's so weird, but it's so fun. You know, even when there's like all the Johnnies and they're arguing amongst themselves,
mm-hmm.
and he says to is it Kelly? Is that her name? Kelly?
Yeah, Kelly. Yeah,
Kelly. You have to watch the money. And she says, "What for?" He says, "Oh, don't trust these cunts." That's right. They're all you.
They're all you. And you think, because there's that part of when you sit and you question, like, if you're like me, like when you go to do something, if it's not like the most mundane thing, even the most mundane thing, you'll be like, should I do it or should I not do it? So you question things. And that's what I love about that scene where they're all kind of chatting amongst each other. And yeah, they're all like, well, you know, maybe we should do this. No, we should totally do this. We should totally do that. It's that idea of, like, the fractured brain is all these different personalities. In theory, what should happen is they should all decide on the same thing, because ultimately, you know, they're all one brain. They're all clones of the same person. But then at the same time, some have lived 5 minutes longer, 10 minutes longer, 20 minutes longer. And if that's the case, those 20 minutes might shape your experience. It's those small attentions to detail from a writing side of things that I get behind, that, you know, I really, really enjoy. And it's why I think, like, let's put it this way, there is a very good chance that there is a high proportion of your listenership have never seen Mega Time Squad. It's a small indie movie, Arrow's put out, but it's still not a, you know, it's only been out a few years. It's not really acquired that cult status yet. I think it will. But I would say, you know, if you're looking for a fucking fun movie to shove on with a group of friends on a Saturday night, once you can have friends back round again, or even do like a fucking, like an online screening with your friends in Zoom or something like that. If you're looking for a movie that you can just kick on and have fun with, Mega Time Squad is right up near the top. There are a few movies that just give pure unadulterated entertainment and joy than this movie.
Yeah, that's it. It is just unadulterated entertainment. It doesn't take itself too seriously, doesn't fucking care, and it just goes, you know, if you want to watch it and have a laugh and learn a whole lot of really exciting, like, New Zealand phrases and idioms, which is great. And one of my favourites is still, would you like a hoon on Magoon? See, I actually didn't know that Kiwis called it a goon as well, but clearly they do. Mm-hmm. So, while I'm there, the container inside the Boxo wine, mm-hmm. that is called a goon sack. Don't ask me why, I don't know, but it's a goon sack. And you want a hoon on my goon is not a euphemism for you to want to polish my knob.
Yeah.
But... And you should
it
call.
It could be,
but it might be. You just don't know. Yeah. But look, 100% agree. This movie is fucking massive fun. It is like low budget, but doesn't show low budget really. Mm-hmm. You know, not overuse of the CGI, which is fucking great. Mm-hmm. And it's just, yeah, doesn't take, it's just, I mean, even the point, like, after they're chasing Jonny through the hotel and, like, one of the Johnnies is being killed, there's a gag about the manager's room smelling like jizz.
Yes.
tidy up your room, it smells like jizz. It's just like fucking, yep, that's it. Just move on. Yeah. Even after, like, Jonny sees his own corpse, it's had his face blown up, he drops his keys in it and it's just like, ugh.
Yeah.
Does not give a shit. So there we go, ladies and gentlemen. That has been a very brief and informal chat with the man, the myth, the legend, Duncan McLeish, about Mega Time Squad from 2018. You should watch it. This is all going to turn to shit, and I'm going to disappear up my own arsehole.
Can I just say before you cut me off and I go away, I promise myself that I wouldn't get sentimental and sappy at the end of this episode, especially because we've been talking about Jism and Goonsacks and God knows what else during the recording, but it has been an absolute honour and pleasure to take part in Wych versus the Doomsday Clock over the 3 years, that's fucking insane, that you've been running this. Genuinely think, and I've said it many times before, and there is a reason that I play your promo as much as I do, one of my favourite shows out there. It will be sorely missed, but if you haven't taken the plunge yet over to your new venture, listeners, over checking out what the Wych is doing with a whole lot of gangster and gang movies on the Gangs of Hollywood podcast, do it. Trust me, I'm not just saying that because I've also recorded over there, but it's a seamless transition and a playground of movies which... some are very popular, some are totally, you know, under your radar for sure. You go across, check them out, and continue supporting this man's hard work, because trust me, he's one of the best. So thank you very much for having me on.
Oh, thank you, Sarah. I'm all a little weepy, and not just in my eyes.
Hi-yo.
You have been listening to Wych versus the Doomsday Clock, a proud member of the Legion Podcast Network. Come join the rest of the Meat Popsicles in our Facebook group, facebook.com/groups/Wych versus the Doomsday Clock.